You're trying to make that switch from After Effects to Fusion, but the workflows are completely different. And annoyingly, all the effects that you normally use have different names now. So you've got no idea what to search for when you're looking for an effect. So let's fix that. Now we're going to cover off a lot of stuff here, so if you need a quick intro course, I'd highly recommend that you check out my video on the basics of Fusion for After Effects users. In this, I cover off how nodes work, how to layer up elements, and how to adjust keyframes, so it's worth a watch if you're brand new to Fusion. With that out of the way, let's get into it. CC Power Pin in After Effects lets you skew images to fit onto screens and mockups, and we normally just apply this as an effect onto the image we want to skew in After Effects. Then we can use these handles here to reposition what we want on our screen. Now in Fusion, the process is very similar. It's called a corner positioner. And if we have one image merged over the other in Fusion, we can apply this corner positioner before the merge and then use the handles here to reposition our image. Super simple. That's good for a static shot, but what if we have a moving shot like this? Well, in After Effects, what we'd normally do is use our tracker tool and track the motion using a perspective corner pin tracker. Then we would apply the results of this to another layer in the composition, like a video or an image. Now in Fusion, there's a bunch of trackers that we can use, but by far the most similar one to After Effects is the planar tracker. So first we select the corners of our screen as a tracking point using this. And then we'll track this from start to end. So it's going to track all these points here. And then from here, we want to change the operation mode to corner pin. From there, you can carefully select the corners of the screen. This is where we're going to map the image onto. So if we then feed our image or video into the green input of the planar tracker, then there you go. You've got the basics of a screen replacement done. Mesh Warp is a useful effect in After Effects that lets you define a grid pattern and then skew and warp whatever you've applied this to. And using this, you could create some really trippy effects. In Fusion, this is called the grid warp. And we just apply this as a node in the chain after whatever we want to warp. And from here, it literally just works the exact same way as the mesh warp in After Effects. So we could customize how many cells we have in the grid. And this gives us a bit more control over where we warp it from. And this brings me nicely onto our next one. So the Bezier Warp in After Effects is sort of similar to the CC Power Pin, but instead we have these handles here where we can curve. So this can be really handy if you want to overlay on something like a curved monitor, for example, and you can use these handles to do that. The corner positioner won't allow us to do this in Fusion because it only allows straight lines. But instead, if we add a grid warp again and select selected as the magnet type, and then bring our X and Y grid sizes down to 1, then we can essentially do the exact same thing using the grid warp. The mirror effect does exactly that. It mirrors something. So with this little eye animation here, if I wanted to mirror this in After Effects, I'd just come up and select mirror from the effects panel and drag this on. Now in Fusion, this is part of the open effects group in the effects tab, and it's just called mirrors. So again, we just add this in the chain after whatever we want to mirror, and there you have it. A really handy node if you want to make something perfectly symmetrical. Now something you do a lot in After Effects is moving the anchor point. Now this is handy if you want to change the position of where a shape transforms from. So for example, if I wanted to rotate this shape here, I can move the anchor point to change where it rotates from. In Fusion, this is called the pivot, and you'll find this on every transform node under the position controls. And this little green indicator on the viewer window here shows you where it goes. You can also click on it and move it around in the viewer window, just like in After Effects. The pick whip is a really handy tool for being able to connect different parameters together. So for example, if we wanted to have the size of this square match the size of this circle, we could pick whip their sizes together and then control them using just one control. Now in Fusion, it works in a very similar way. So I've got two shapes set up here and they're connected to their own transform nodes. Now if we highlight the transform control for the square here, and then we hit this pin icon, this lets us pin these controls to the inspector window, regardless of what node we have selected. I'll then click on the circle transform, and I'm going to right click on the size parameter and go to expression. This little text box is going to pop up here with a plus icon. Now if we click and drag the plus icon, you'll see this basically works like a pick whip. So because we've pinned the square transform controls, I can simply connect this to the square size, and then we've connected these together in the exact same way that we would in After Effects. So sometimes in After Effects, it's helpful to be able to separate dimensions. So for something like the position of this shape here, we might want to separate the X and Y axis from each other on the position value so that we can control them independently. Now in After Effects, we just right click and go separate dimensions, and that's them separated as their own values. In Fusion, on the position parameter, we right click, go modify with, and select XY path. Then if we jump up to our modifiers tab here, we could see that we have the individual controls for the X and Y axis, and we could keyframe these directly. This is really handy if you want to pick whip one of these parameters to something like the size, for example. I can just add an expression, grab this, and hover over the tools button to come back to the tools and then connect it to the size to join them together. Then as soon as I increase the size, it automatically moves from left to right across the X axis. Now solids do many things in After Effects. They could double up as an adjustment layer, but they can also be used as a background or as a solid fill that you can apply a mask to and create a shape from. And this is very similar to how the background node works in Fusion. So when you're making the switch from After Effects to Fusion, you can think of the background node as your solid layer. It's got a built-in gradient ramp, so there's no need to apply a gradient as an effect. And you can connect a mask to it to basically make any shape you want. Now, another useful tip is to bring the alpha down to zero on a black background and then use this as the basis to build a transparent animation on top of. Once you've done that, you can then layer this over your footage in the edit page of Resolve. This is really useful for things like lower thirds or animations that you want to run over footage. Adding pixelation to your animations is a really popular technique right now to give things a sort of retro 8-bit look. It's one I see a lot of in After Effects tutorials. It gets added as an effect, and you can set how many horizontal and vertical blocks you want. Now in Fusion, it's just a simple node that you can connect different shapes and footage up to. Again, it's in the Open Effects category in the Effects window, and it's called Mosaic Blur, but it has all the same controls as the Mosaic effect in After Effects. So you can use this one if you want to create some 8-bit retro goodness. This is one I've talked a lot about in different tutorials already, but within After Effects, you have this drop down on each layer to control the blend mode. So for example, we can blend this gradient layer as an overlay to the rest of our composition. Well, in Fusion, this is controlled within the merge node itself, and it's called the apply mode. So this will affect the blend for the foreground input of that merge. So if we wanted to create the same overlay effect, we'd merge the overlay gradient with our footage and then click on the merge node and change the apply mode to overlay. And that gives us the exact same look. Sometimes they have slightly different names, but you'll find all the same blend modes in that dropdown for the merge. CC Sphere lets you warp whatever you apply it to into a perfect sphere, which is a quick little trick for creating planets in After Effects. Now Fusion's got an even more robust 3D system than After Effects, so it's an easy one to replicate. First, we connect our image to a shape 3D node, and then select a sphere as the shape. And then we're going to connect that up to a render 3D node to render that effect out. Now all 3D effects in Fusion have to be connected up to that renderer before we can hook it back into the merge node. But once that's done, it works the exact same way from there. When things get really busy in After Effects, it can be handy to nest some layers by highlighting them, right-clicking and going to pre-compose. This creates another comp for these layers to sit in separately, and it can really help to tidy up larger compositions. For a similar result in Fusion, when you have a really large complicated node tree, you can highlight all the nodes, right-click and go to group. And this will shrink all this stuff down into what looks like one single node, but if you double click on this, you'll see that we're housing all this stuff we had previously had in here. And this is super helpful when you have parts of the node tree that you're finished working on and don't need to come back to. It also tidies things up in the keyframes tab because it groups all of them together. Another benefit of nesting in After Effects is that you can reuse the pre-comps and control them all from one place. Because of how nodes work in Fusion, you could connect this up to another merge node and then you've effectively created a second instance of this element that can be controlled from the one place, similar to how a pre-comp works. And you can do this as many times as you like. It's one of the benefits of nodes. The next one's a super quick one, adding motion blur. Now, applying motion blur is really easy in After Effects. Most layers have this control to add it. In Fusion, any node that controls movement of any kind will usually have a motion blur checkbox in the settings tab of that node. You could turn it on for the node here and control the detail of it using the sliders below. Really easy. CC Reptile is a useful effect for creating patterns from one object. So I could create a single shape and then use CC Reptile to replicate it across the screen multiple times. To create this effect in Fusion, we can actually use a merge node. Down at the bottom of the inspector controls, we'll see a toggle for edges. And this is going to allow us to define what happens with the edges of whatever we're feeding into this merge. Right now, I'm going to select mirror. So because I have this shape fed into the merge node, if I then put a transform node in between the shape and the merge, I can use the size and position controls in here to control how this displays. You can create some really cool looking effects using a displacement map in After Effects. Now I'm not going to explain everything about how a displacement map works in Fusion because I've got that coming up in another video. But if you're already familiar with making a displacement map in After Effects, then what I will say is that Fusion is not that different. In the effects panel, we want to search for displace and then run whatever we want into this. In this case, I'm going to displace some text. Now I'm not going to create a whole unique displacement map for this, but normally we'd connect our displacement map into the input connector here. Just for this example here, I'm going to connect a fast noise node into the input. From in the noise node, we can adjust our contrast and detail, and this will displace the text that's running into it once we adjust the refraction controls. Which is the exact same as how After Effects works. The repeater effect is a handy one in After Effects that lets you multiply simple shapes a number of predefined times. You can even change the position of the repetitions to create some really interesting effects. Within Fusion, the most similar comparison is the duplicate node, and whatever you run into this node will be duplicated. So from here, I could select how many copies I want to repeat and the position between each duplicate. Now, full disclosure here, this is not a like-for-like replacement for the repeater in After Effects. It does function a little bit differently. It sort of works the same way that the repeater would work if you were to apply it to the contents of the shape layer rather than the group. But regardless, it's a really powerful and useful node to be aware of. Because we can adjust the position and size of the duplications, you can use this to create similar effects for what you might normally use the repeater for. Now, the last few examples here are going to require you to install Reactor into Fusion. Now, Reactor, if you're unfamiliar with it, is a directory of third-party tools and plugins that you can add to Fusion completely free of charge. Now, in the description, I've left a link to the We Suck Less forum where you can download the installer for Reactor. If you download this and then drag it into the node viewer, you'll get a little pop-up that asks you to install Reactor. Once that's done, you'll get access to the directory where you can install our next effect, Echo. Now, Echo works the same way that Echo in After Effects works. It's going to create an echo trail for your movements. In Fusion, this will work for whatever we're going to feed into the Echo node. And you can control how many repetitions there are, as well as the gain and size of the trails. It's like an old school motion blur effect, and it's really popular for motion graphics right now. If you like using a drop shadow in After Effects, then you won't be disappointed to see that you can also apply one using the Shadow Node tool in Fusion. But there's a much better version of Shadow in Reactor, and it's called Real Shadow. So we're going to navigate back to Reactor by going to Workspace, Scripts, Reactor, and Open Reactor. And from here, we're going to search for Real Shadow and make sure it's ticked and installed. Real Shadow gives you a much better looking shadow because unlike the default shadow node, which is basically just a duplication, it actually replicates a real shadow trail. And it also gives you this long shadow effect that looks really cool too. This last one was one of my favorites to use in After Effects. The audio spectrum effect will process an audio file as a visual audio spectrum. You can apply it to a video or audio files within After Effects, and there's a whole bunch of controls to adjust the color, height, and thickness of the waveform. This is another one that you could download from Reactor, and it's called Audio Waveform. It works a bit differently in Fusion because it basically works like a generator node. So you have to upload an audio file directly within the node. It only supports wave files, so a quick hack you can use if you don't have your audio in the wave file type is just to do a quick audio only export from Resolve and selecting wave as the format in the audio tab. Other than that, it works in a very similar way. You could create a spectrum effect, and you can control the color, maximum height, and thickness of the spectrum. Perfect if you've got a podcast and you want to cut it up in a quick clip. If you're currently trying to switch away from After Effects, then let me know how I can help. What else do you need to know in order to make the switch? Hit the subscribe button and drop me a message in the comments. And I'll see you in the next one.